मॉर्निंग क्लास
ऊपर भी नहीं।
वी आर लेट फॉर टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन, सो क्विकली मूविंग ऑन टू द प्रेजेंटेशन। आई होप यू आर एबल टू हियर मी। ओके फाइन। सो टुडेज टॉपिक इज कुशन सिंड्रोम। इट्स अ वेरी फेमिलियर टॉपिक आई गेस, एंड very easy topic to deal with. So Cushing syndrome, basically Cushing syndrome is it represent as an area of symptom which result of abnormally high levels of cortisol, and mainly in the form of glucocorticoids in the blood. And you have two entities, one is Cushing syndrome, another one is Cushing disease. The Cushing syndrome is basically excess cortisol, and that could be any cause, exogenous or endogenous. But Cushing disease, especially, this name has been given for any pituitary microadenoma or macroadenoma, which produces excess cortisol, and invariably because pituitary secretes ACTH, so you have high level of ACTH too. So endogenous pituitary cause for excess cortisol is Cushing's disease. So this syndrome basically can be caused by, which is one of the most common causes, the iatrogenic. Iatrogenic is by overuse of cortisol medications, as you can you have seen in the treatment of chronic asthma, and even in treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, where the patient has been put on steroid for a long period of time, even inhalation steroid for a long period of time. So that leads to excess production of cortisol. And then the other one is the excess production of cortisol from a tumor in the adrenal gland or elsewhere in the body, which is an ectopic Cushing syndrome. And if a tumor in the pituitary gland secreting ACTH will stimulate the overproduction of cortisol from the adrenal gland, that is the basically Cushing disease which we talked about. So the etiology wise, you have exogenous and endogenous. Exogenous most common is iatrogenic, basically that is overuse of glucocorticoids and prolonged administration of glucocorticoids basically. And in endogenous, you can have ACTH-dependent causes or ACTH-independent causes. So ACTH-dependent are like hypothalamic lesions, which increases CRH production and invariably increases ACTH production. And that ACTH will go on to stimulate the adrenal cortex and to secrete, and that will lead to secretion of glucocorticoids through the from the second layer of the adrenal cortex, which is fasciculator. Then you have pituitary lesions that can be in form of microadenoma or macroadenoma. Again, this will produce excess amount of ACTH, because these are endogenous pituitary lesions which are autonomous, which is doesn't regulate under the feedback mechanism, and these are autonomous producing mostly non-malignant, and it causes excess secretion of ACTH. And then you have ectopic lesions, and the ectopic ACTH producing lesions are found in the, especially in the lung carcinoma, Oat cell carcinoma, or a bronchial carcinoid, or a pancreatic carcinoma, or neuroblastoma, or even Wilms tumor. So these are the ectopic reason for production of ACTH. Then you have ACTH independent causes. So ACTH independent causes are basically that is through the production of increased cortisol or endogenous adrenal adenoma or carcinoma or bilateral adrenal hyperplasia, and that will invariably produce increased cortisol, and but it's not accompanied by increased ACTH, rather the ACTH levels are decreased through the feedback mechanism. Are you I hope you are able to hear me. So audio quality is good, so we'll move on to the next slide. Prevalence wise Cushing syndrome basically the pituitary adenoma accounts for more than 70% of the cases in the adults, and if you can combine children and adolescent, maybe up to 60 to 70%. And the Cushing syndrome most commonly affects adult ages 20 to 50 and is more prevalent in females, and accounts for about 70% of all cases. But the presentation, usually the age of presentation for pituitary adenoma may be a little higher, more than 50 years of age. So pathophysiology, as you can see, the hypothalamus is in the brain and pituitary gland just sits just below it. And there is a paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus which releases corticotropin releasing hormone, which stimulates the pituitary gland to release ACTH. And this ACTH travels via the blood to the adrenal gland, where it stimulates the release of cortisol. And this cortisol is basically secreted by the cortex of the adrenal gland from a region which is called zona fasciculata, which is in response to ACTH. And so the elevated level of cortisol exerts negative feedback on CRH in the hypothalamus, which decreases the amount of ACTH released from the anterior pituitary gland. This is all about the normal physiology of the hormonal level. So we try to stress on this point that Cushing syndrome refers to excess cortisol of any etiology, while the one of the causes of Cushing syndrome is a cortisol secreting adenomas in the cortex of the adrenal gland, where the cortisol levels is very high, and through the negative feedback on the pituitary, the high cortisol levels suppresses ACTH level. Whereas the Cushing disease is any hypercortisolism secondary to excess production of ACTH from pituitary adenoma, or excess production of even hypothalamic CRH. So and when Cushing syndrome is due to excess ACTH, it is known as ectopic Cushing syndrome, which we seen in even in the paraplastic syndrome. Symptoms wise, Cushing syndrome, corticosteroid, as far as corticosteroid is concerned, three main functions you should remember. It helps in the gluconeogenesis. Secondary, it is basically, it increases the metabolism because it is also called a stress hormone. So it causes proteinolysis. So proteinolysis or proteolysis, or as well as lipolysis. So it causes neogluconeogenesis, proteolysis and lipolysis. And there will be a redistribution of fat. And then in order to respond to the stressful condition, you might find in glucocorticoid causing increase in peripheral resistance in blood vessels, and that can lead to increase in blood pressure. And the other thing is whenever there is a glucocorticoid secretion enhanced, it has an anti-inflammatory action, but at the same time it decrease the neutrophilic function and the immunity, overall immunity of the body. That's why glucocorticoid in acute infection, we don't tend to give glucocorticoid in acute infection, because it tends to exacerbate any acute infection, either be bacterial or a fungal. So because of the excess glucocorticoid, then glucocorticoid, this cortisol, they have basically a very mild mineralocorticoid action, and through the mineralocorticoid action, as you can see, through the stimulation of mineralocorticoid receptor, which enhances the water absorption and sodium absorption as well, so that can lead to hypertension and hypernatremia. We will talk about it as you take up every single symptoms, like excess glucocorticoids will lead to weight gain, obviously because of the redistribution of the fat, and even the there may be a certain amount of edema because of proteolysis. There will be decreased albumin in the body, or either decreased protein in the body, and it leads to especially the redistribution of lipids through the inactivation of lipoprotein lipase. There will be accumulation of fat in around the stomach area or the truncal area, and the second thing is in around the face, and it leads to a moon facies, which is a characteristic of this disease, and truncal obesity. While the there is one special term for this, it's like a lemon on a matchstick appearance, because the limbs, because of the muscle metabolism, hyperactive, because of the proteolysis in the muscles, so there is a substantial muscle weakness and a decrease in the muscle growth and the muscle mass. So it will lead to and there is an analogy which is in the name of lemon on stick appearance. So as you can see, the heavy trunk and thin extremities. Then there is a buffalo hump in the neck. That is because of the fat on the neck area, especially on the nape of the neck, on the backside. So it form of a buffalo hump. Then you will be having a thin skin, and the skin will be because of again it has a in because of the proteolysis action. There will be a thinner of skin and fragility. The skin will be more fragile and more prone to injuries. And then you have a formation of, because of the increase in weight gain and fragility of the skin, there is something called stria. It forms a more of a purple colored stria over the flanks in the abdomen, and even can present on the thighs also. Moon faces we talked about. Then you have the muscle wasting. As I said, there will be proteolysis, so there will be muscle wasting. Osteoporosis, again there will be osteoclastic lesion will be there, and because of that, because of the action of glucocorticoid, there can be a very known adverse effect of glucocorticoid. This is osteoporosis. Then you can have there is mental clouding or a mental dislocation with memory loss. This is how it affects the brain. The exact etiology is not known, but it has been found in the patients with Cushing disease, and there is obviously increased susceptibility to infection. Then excess mineral corticoid action. As I said, the glucocorticoid have a milder mineral corticoid action, so invariably it will cause, along with the increase in peripheral resistance, will be accompanied increase in water absorption and sodium absorption, and it can lead to hypertension and hypernatremia because of the decrease intravascular volume and increase intravascular sodium. Hypokalemia can be because of the return to increased sodium absorption, there will be potassium and hydrogen secretion or excretion through the tubules, so it can lead to hypokalemia or even hypokalemic alkalosis, which is a very diagnostic feature of Cushing syndrome. Then weight gain and edema and expanded blood volume, as we talked about. And again, it has a slight action through the excess androgens as well. It has a very mixed action because especially the Cushing patient with excess cortisol, it has invariably excess androgen action, and where in women especially it causes hirsutism, breast atrophy, clitoris enlargement, and a vice masculinity. While in men, it basically causes loss of libido. But especially in ACTH dependent, this as we talk about the Cushing disease, this excess androgen action, and it has can have a menstrual abnormalities in the form of oligomenorrhea, and basically, there can be when the cortisol level is high, or this is because of the especially the cortisol secreting tumors, then can lead to inhibition of ACTH and inhibition of gonadotropin releasing hormone, and invariably that will lead to decrease in FSH and LH secretion, and that will lead to amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea, and which is one of the very common feature, and it is one of the commonest feature of infertility in female, and that's why whenever a very common feature is PCOD, which is one of the most common cause for infertility in the younger age group, so it has to be differentiated from PCOD. Then the gastrointestinal features will have a peptic ulceration, pancreatitis, gastritis, and duodenitis. Ophthalmic, as you all know, the cataract and glaucoma it can lead to. And the other features are non-significant tachycardia, fatty liver, then migraines, and then can be adenoma can causing a mass effect with the headache, persistent headache, or bitemporal hemianopia, that is a visual blurring, and syncope or superficial skin infections. So this is basically the different body fat. You have the central obesity, supraclavicular fat, fat pads, muscle will we have muscle atrophy and weakness and proximal muscle weakness. Then skin will we have thinning of the skin, facial plethora, easy bruising and valacious stria. Then osteoporosis and fracture, patients are more prone to fractures. Then CVS, if you are in CVS, you can see hypertension, CCF and hyperlipidemia and diabetes. This is what I forgot to mention. It has lead can lead to neoglycogenesis, impair insulin sensitivity, and increase insulin resistance, and will lead to diabetes invariably. And most of the, such patients will be insulin dependent too. Immunity, increased rate of infection, poor wound healing. Interesting. Class mein ho.
मैं बताता हूँ
इंक्रीज रेट ऑफ इन्फेक्शन पुअर वुंड हीलिंग एंड रिप्रोडक्टिव यू हैव गोनाड्रियल डिसफंक्शन एंड मेंस्ट्रुअल इररेगुलरिटीज एंड साइकोसिस कैन बी वन ऑफ द फीचर्स वी टॉक्ड अबाउट देयर कैन बी अ डिप्रेशन और इमोशनल लेबिलिटी और इरिटेबिलिटी और स्लीप डिस्टर्बेंसेस सो नाउ द इम्पॉर्टेंट इज द इवेल्युएशन clinically, the clinical features and area are so typical of Cushing's syndrome that it is hardly difficult to miss a patient of Cushing's syndrome, and you can hardly make a step wrong when you are talking clinically in assessing all the features of the Cushing's syndrome. But when it comes to making a diagnosis or labeling a diagnosis in any endocrinology, you need to have a proper evaluation, and you have a set of certain tests, and one of the tests which is a screening test to confirm a hypercortisolism, and that screening test is in the form of a single dose or overnight dexamethasone suppression test, or you can get a 24-hour urinary free cortisol or even late night salivary cortisol level. So this late night salivary cortisol level is one of the recent advancement which have shown to the patients with Cushing disease. They have a high level of salivary cortisol, especially late at night. One thing you should always remember, this cortisol, this glucocorticoid secretion happens in, it has a diurnal variation, higher in the early morning secretion and lower in the late evening secretion. So that diurnal variation, there is always a spike in cortisol secretion early in the morning when you are ready to get set and go for your routine activities or for your job. So it's a type of body's preparedness to handling any stress or right in the beginning of your day you will have higher cortisol level, especially early morning 4 to 6 p.m. a.m. you will have corticosteroid spurts, and you will have a later part of the day you will have a lesser cortisol secretion or a constant low cortisol secretion. But it always be this hormone is basically had diurnal variation and is secreted in spurts. So 24-hour urinary free cortisol is another one of the earlier tests to screen for primary hypercortisolism. And then after that you can get a single dose, low dose dexamethasone suppression test, where you give 1 milligram tablet to the patient at around 10 or 11 p.m. in the night, and then you measure the cortisol level अर्ली इन द मॉर्निंग, मे बी 6 AM और 7 AM, एंड यू लुक फॉर द रिजल्ट. इफ यू हैव नॉर्मल रिस्पॉन्स विल बी बिकॉज ऑफ द लेट नाइट डेक्सामेथासोन, यू विल हैव सप्रेस वैल्यू ऑफ कॉर्टिसोल, यूजुअली विल बी वैल्यू विल बी लेस देन 50 nanomole per liter, एंड दैट इज that's invariably rules out Cushing's syndrome. Well, the dose over here is given 2 milligram. It can be given in the form of 2 or 1 milligram. And if the cortisol level early in the morning comes to a value less than 50 nanomole per liter, then it's indicative of adequate suppression. Well, the second screening test, where you will have again you can give 8 doses of dexamethasone every 6 hours for 2 days. And then again you four doses for 2 days. Either way, you can then measure serum cortisol on the first day and the second day, and suppression of cortisol again rules out the Cushing syndrome. So basically, if the levels are suppressed, obviously it rules out Cushing syndrome. But if levels are not suppressed, then that is more diagnostic of Cushing syndrome. Late night salivary cortisol test is a relatively new test, as I talked about, and it checks for the elevated level of cortisol in the saliva between 11 p.m. and midnight. And usually the cortisol secretion is very low in the night, so in patient with Cushing syndrome, that level will be elevated during this time. Then, so the normal level of late night salivary cortisol will virtually exclude the diagnosis of Cushing syndrome. As far as this test is concerned, it has a 93% to 100% diagnostic accuracy rate. Then treatment of Cushing syndrome has been established. The next step is to find out the cause. And the cause is whether it is ACTH dependent or ACTH independent. If lower undetectable ACTH, invariably it means that it is an adrenal cause. And if it's a high level of ACTH, then it can be again Cushing disease or ectopic ACTH syndrome. And to differentiate between the two, now the next step is high dose dexamethasone suppression test. The high dose dexamethasone suppression test, again you will give 2 milligrams 6 hourly for 2 days, and then cortisol level measured at 8 p.m. on day 0 and day 2. And if there is a partial suppression of cortisol more than 50%, it confirms a pituitary cause or a Cushing disease. And if there is a failure to suppress the cortisol level, then again it suggests ectopic ACTH syndrome. A CRH is where you give 100 microgram of bovine CRH, but it has not of a very practical importance, more of a historical importance, where serum ACTH and cortisol measured for 2 hours and increased ACTH and cortisol signifies pituitary Cushing, while the no response signifies ectopic ACTH syndrome. So the common summary of finding, you can surmise it as adrenal lesion, you have a high level of unfractioned cortisol, and when you do a high dose dexamethasone suppression test, the levels won't be suppressed, while ACTH level will be low and CRH will be negative. Well, in case of pituitary macroadenoma or microadenoma, you will have again a high unfractioned cortisol, levels are high, and high dose dexamethasone suppression test will be suppressed in microadenoma, not suppressed in macroadenoma. ACTH level will be high and CRH will be positive. In ectopic cases, again you will have high UFFC, then the high dose dexamethasone won't be suppressed, and you have high ACTH and negative CRH. And exogenous cause, again the unfractioned cortisol will be basically low, and it will be not suppressed, and the ACTH will be low and the CRH will be negative. Other investigation to rule out, obviously CT MRI, CT of the MRI of the abdomen to rule out for the adrenal adenoma or carcinoma or USG abdomen. Then for Cushing disease, you can get a CT MRI head done. And if there is no masses, then you can do a bilateral inferior petrosal blood sampling for ACTH level. And it is especially done in a hospital setting, and where the inferior petrosal blood sampling is done, and it is again for looking for pituitary micro or macro adenoma. Then ectopic ACTH, you get an X-ray, CT chest, CT abdomen, looking for any Hodgkin cell carcinoma or a Wilms tumor or bronchial carcinoid. So the basically algorithm is whenever your Cushing syndrome is suspected, get a 24 hours urinary free cortisol or overnight dexamethasone suppression test, and if it is excluded, no further test is needed. If it's not excluded, again 48 hours low dose dexamethasone suppression test, morning and midnight cortisol is seen, and if Cushing syndrome confirmed, you can get a plasma ACTH, and if detectable, it is ACTH dependent, and you can get a 48 hours high dose dexamethasone test, and where if it is suppressed, it is a pituitary source. If it is not suppressed, it is an ectopic source. And if the plasma ACT is in undetectable, it invariably the cause will point towards the adrenal cause. So these are certain differential diagnoses like simple obesity or generalized corticoid resistance or pseudo Cushing syndrome because of the chronic alcoholism and severe depression, but there won't be any clinical evidences of Cushing syndrome, or the clinical picture of Cushing syndrome will be lacking, and patient may exhibit hypertension or hypokalemia and precocious pseudo puberty. So now coming on to treatment. So treatment you have for iatrogenic, where you have to discontinue, or rather than discontinue, reduce the dose of steroid if possible, because sudden tapering or sudden discontinuing of the steroid can lead to Addisonian crisis. So again, you have then you can taper the dose and then stop the steroid after a period of time. And in pituitary cause, obviously the first line treatment is transfemoral surgery plus and minus pituitary irradiation, and you can consider bilateral adenectomy or medical therapy for recurrent Cushing's disease. In adrenal, you have unilateral adenectomy, and if it's a bilateral, then you get a bilateral adenectomy, and along with replacement therapy with glucocorticoid for a lifelong. And if it's an ectopic, then you have to look for the ectopic of the dissection of the ectopic sources, or bilateral adrenalectomy and medical therapy. So, talking about the adrenalectomy, as far as transsphenoidal pituitary microsurgery is again a treatment of choice in pituitary Cushing disease, and the overall success rate is up to in 10 years up to 60-80%. Low post-operative serum or urinary cortisol concentration predict long-term remission in the majority of the case. Relapses again treated with reoperation or pituitary irradiation. And in adrenalectomy, you can have irresponsiveness to treatment if ACTH is secreted by the ectopic metastatic tumor, and it may lead to Nelson syndrome when there is an increased ACTH secretion by an undissected pituitary adenoma, or there can be evidence mainly by the marked hyperpigmentation. So there will be a residual or undissected pituitary adenoma, or there might be when you don't replace in cases of adenectomy with you don't do the glucocorticoid replacement, there will be increased ACTH secretion, and since ACTH also acts on the melanocyte receptors, it can lead to marked hyperpigmentation. This is a very important point which I forget to mention. This is usually the ACTH secreting tumors, they are invariably accompanied with hyperpigmentation, while solely a cortisol secreting adrenal tumors, they don't present with hyperpigmentation. So such patients require adequate pre-operative and post-operative replacement therapy so that the patient doesn't fall into the Nelson syndrome. And you might even try preoperative irradiation before the adenectomy or post-adenectomy. And other post-operative complications are such as pancreatitis, thrombosis, poor wound healing, and sudden collapse. Medical therapy or medical replacement therapy in the form of inhibitions of adrenal steroidogenesis, that is through metaraporin or ketoconazole, which is very a common drug, aminoglutethimide or etomidate. So metaraporin and ketoconazole use for the as a medical for inhibition of adrenal steroidogenesis, especially preoperatively to normalize the circulating cortisol levels, and even in cases resistant to adrenalectomy or patient if the patient is not fit for adrenalectomy, you can try medical suppression of adrenal steroidogenesis. And for centrally acting serotonin agonists like cyproheptadine and bromocriptine, they are also known to block ACTH release. So this is all about Cushing syndrome and the Cushing disease. Thank you so much. And quickly we'll move on to the 20 questions which we have left out in our internal assessment. We have successfully covered up the first 40 questions. We'll take up the rest of the 20 questions which are left out. Start with the question number 41. Pulmonary embolism causes all except. Obviously, there won't be a decrease heart rate. The embolism will lead to increased heart rate. This as a stress response. Normal individuals tend to their heart tends to beat fast, so it won't never be a bradycardia. It will always be a tachycardia, and decreased cardiac output. Arterial hypoxemia and acute right ventricular strain, which is a part of parcel of pulmonary embolism. Most common symptom of pulmonary embolism, obviously it's a dyspnea. Whenever patient comes to you, a most common symptom will be definitely dyspnea. Even in hospitalized patient who post-operated patients, they mostly come to you or complain of dyspnea, or there is a desaturation. You on tachycardia and decrease in blood pressure, then you tend to suspect pulmonary embolism. Chest pain is again very common, and hemoptysis can be there, and cough can also be there. Which of the diabetes has impaired glucose-induced secretion of insulin with preserved beta cell mass? It's basically a MODY. MODY is a maturity onset diabetes of the young, which is again a non-insulin dependent. It is basically. Glimepiride is a drug which is very effective in this, and it is an autosomal dominant with a genetic base for the for this entity, and this MODY usually presents in a younger age, and the patient invariably do very well with the glimepiride or the sulfonylureas. They are very important to note down that they are not insulin dependent. Then LADA is basically as we touch on the LADA is a latent autoimmune disease of adult, which is again skeptically it is an insulin dependent diabetes which present to you at a later stage or maybe more than 30 years of age. While MODY is a non-insulin dependent which present to you at an early age. And LADA is again, as it is in the, maybe the patient with LADA might respond to oral hypoglycemic early in their course, but eventually they will need insulin for their treatment, and they are accompanied with एंटीबॉडी, दैट इज इंटरस्टीशियल एंटीबॉडीज एंड गैड एंटीबॉडी. Then type 1 disease and Wolfram syndrome, this is a area of syndrome of finding of diabetes insipidus and diabetes mellitus and deafness, and it is an again a genetic auto partially autosomal recessive syndrome. Again it is insulin dependent. ADA criteria for diagnosis of diabetes: HbA1c greater than 6.5, fasting blood sugar greater than 126, classical symptoms of hypoglycemia plus the RBS greater than 200 that eventually brand a patient with diabetes. Yes, all of the above. Most common cause of death in type 2 diabetes, obviously it has to be cardiovascular disease, especially the myocardial infarction is the most common cause of death in cases of diabetes mellitus. CORB 65 criteria, criteria and pneumonia prognosis, which gives you a mortality index. Age is there greater than 65, as it seen in the acronym. Then respiratory rate greater than 30, blood urea nitrogen level greater than 17 millimore or 19 milligram per deciliter, and systolic blood pressure, obviously it has to be hypotension, not systolic blood pressure greater than 90, it will be lesser than 90. And this is the CURB 65 criteria, which so depending on the you have a point system for every feature, you have a point system, and depending on the ascending order of the point system, the mortality rates increases in cases of hospitalized patient with pneumonia. And C starts for confusion, that's mental obtentation. Increased rates index is classically seen in, again this is very common term, and this is a very common question. It happens in a chronic bronchitis where you have enhanced submucous gland thickness as compared to the when compared to the ratio of the submucous gland to the subepithelial and cartilage bronchial cartilage thickness, which is more than 0.5. Metformin is not used in severe renal dysfunction, can lead to lactic acidosis. Severe hepatic dysfunction, it is contraindicated, and in diabetic ketoacidosis, definitely all of the above. Side effect of sulfonylurea is hypoglycemia, weight gain, skin reaction, again all of the above. Klebsiella pneumonia, everything is true about except yes, it is a red currant jelly sputum. Seen in alcoholics, seen in older age, it's a very resistant kind of bacteria, and it responds to a broader spectrum cephalosporin. What is the most common cause of skin infection? And here you will have streptococcal pyogenes. This is the you will be touched in skin. In the skin lecture, when Dr. Samudra will take it for you, these questions are set by Dr. Samudra. How long is the life cycle of scabies mite? It is 30 days. And about scabies, you will be taught in the skin lectures. The only significant gram negative, I think this should have been gram positive, not gram negative, and that answer is cornibacteria. Meaning of vulgaris is common. And meaning of herpes is to creep. You know the herpes infection. It tends to creep along the dermatome. So meaning of herpes is creep. Bronchial asthma may be complicated with infection with aspergillus fumigatus, which is a common fungal infection. Sudden onset of cough with increasing dyspnea in young adult is due to, obviously in a young adult, and a normal young adult, or with a sudden onset of coughing and sudden dyspnea or increasing dyspnea, pneumothorax will be the, obviously pneumothorax, that is the first thing you will think about, which is this is an emergency, absolute emergency. Because of pneumothorax, as the name suggests, there will be air in the pleura. Because of the rupture of the bleb, there will be air trapping in the pleura, and that will lead to massive pressure on the lungs, and can lead to desaturation, and even can lead to pushing of hemithorax to one side, and it can be that sudden desaturation, and the patient might need intubation if not addressed immediately. Fine crepitation at the end of inspiration is seen and is very typical of interstitial lung diseases. Diagnosis of bronchial asthma on PFT is accomplished by post bronchodilator nebulization, and there will be obviously increase in FEV1 of 12% or more, absolute increase in FEV1 for at least 200 millimeter, and both are diagnostic criteria for diagnosis of bronchial asthma. Initial management of blood glucose in adults with diabetes mellitus type 2 is obviously anything, medical nutrition therapy, exercise, and weight loss. These all are the initial management of blood glucose in adults with diabetes type 2. So this is all for the question which were left out, and we have covered up our part. A part of a section of endocrine. Now we'll take up Addison's disease in the next class, and we'll soon finish up with the PCT hyperparathyroid, and then we'll wrap up our endocrinology, and we can take up the some other system after that. Thank you so much, class, for your patient listening. Thank you so much.